Good afternoon. Looks like about 20% of the EPC family as folks are coming in. My name's Tom Ricks. I am the National Director of Church Planting for our denomination. And last year, if you were here, if you were here, you missed what happened in Denver. But if you were in Denver, you remember that church planting kicked everything off. We were number one. And Mike Moses and I had the opportunity to share with you vision, kind of philosophy of church planting, along with kind of what does that look like in the EPC? And as God continues to lead us and as our church planting culture continues to grow, I wouldn't say we're flourishing yet, but we are in a growing model. We want to continue building that into our DNA. We're one of four gospel initiatives. You've heard the other three already. So last year I said, you know, they want to lead off with the best and really set the bar high. This year I'm saying we save the best for last. But they are all intertwined. They all complement one another. We all collaborate together. And I am proud to work alongside folks like Gabriel and Annie and Michael and Bob. I don't know about Stoffer, but I'm proud. I love you. I am proud to be seen with them in public and work with them behind the scenes for the kingdom of God. Our denomination, with the folks that are leading those gospel initiatives, is incredibly served. And I am so thankful that I get to rub elbows with those folks and learn from them and grow from them. So for our part today, in a moment, Warren Bird is going to be taking the stage, and he is going to be talking to us about church planting on several different levels, really church multiplication. So church planting, we've already heard several folks talk about, you know, planting one church. Multiplication is planting churches that plant churches, that grow church planting very naturally in our denomination. So a word about Warren Bird. He has written or co-authored 35 books on church health, church growth. He is considered, if you read the folks who know about the research side of the church world, Warren Bird would be considered probably the foremost expert when it comes to large churches in the United States of America. What makes them that way, what makes them grow, what are some of the challenges they have, so on and so forth. But beyond that, in practical experience, Warren Bird was himself a church planter. He's been involved in planting churches as a pastor. He has also written extensively on that topic. So we are very fortunate to have somebody who's been there and done that and is very wise and is very knowledgeable in church planting. Now, he told me the most important thing that he wanted me to say was not everything I just said. Because I know a lot about church planting. I have a deep well of understanding of church planting, and he's forgotten more than I'll ever know. So I like to say that because I want you to have confidence that the folks that we put up here really are experts in their field. But he doesn't care if I say any of that. He said, make sure you say this. And I think he fits in well with us. We're going to adopt you. You're going to be an EPC son today. He said, make sure the EPC knows that above everything else, I really love Jesus and I want to love him as much as I possibly can. So with that most important part of the introduction, would you please welcome Dr. Warren Bird as he comes and shares with us this afternoon.
Thank you. Hey, thank you. Let me start by telling you what this message is not. It's not about me talking the whole time. I'll start solo, then we'll take a stretch break, then we'll finish more with a panel discussion of people who are much more interesting than me. And just to tease you, one of them, a panelist, is Pastor Tim Johnson, who you heard from yesterday morning. My message is also not about all the headwinds facing American Christianity currently. Yes, they are very real, and I'm going to play a 45-second clip from an interview that my friend researcher Ryan Burge was on that pretty much summarizes in less than 1 minute the negative that you'll hear from my talk. Here's Ryan.
Because age is a killer, you know, like it's hard to tell people this, but I'm like, actuarially, you're not long for this world, you know, like as a life insurance agent would say. And if you look at it, like, especially a lot of white Christian churches, holy cow, things are not looking good at all. I mean, the Episcopalians, good gracious. They had 375,000 people on an average Sunday, and over half of them have seen their 60th birthday. You know, just do the math, right? Just game that out in 20 years, and you're going to lose at least half your people in 20 years. And how do you sustain a denomination with less than 200,000 people nationwide? But listen, the Southern Baptists are not in a whole lot better spot. The average Southern Baptist is in their late 50s now, and there's not this huge chunk of, you know, 25 to 30-year-olds who are aging into leadership in the SBC to kind of replace all those people that will be aging out of leadership over the next 15 or 20 years. There's just no evidence in the data that most, not all, that most denominations are going to be the same size or larger in 20 years than they are right now. I would think that most, the vast majority, 90%+ are going to be demonstrably smaller. Obviously, I can't model the Holy Spirit. I can't model revival. Mm-hmm. All those things are possible. But if you just follow the trend lines and where they're going, it does not look good for almost all denominational Protestant Christianity right now.
Okay, there was your bad news. But actually, there's a lot of good news out there. For example, 88% of American adults engage in a spiritual or religious activity weekly or more. Now, this Fetzer survey was very broad. People, what do you consider to be spiritual? If it's yoga, if it's nature walks with your God or gods, but however you define it, and of course, church going, however you define it, 88%. Or Pew study, 78% of American adults are either spiritual or religious or both. So, you know, the people who say, well, I'm religious but not spiritual. Okay, let's take those together. Let's get rid of the overlap. And we end up with 78%. If you caught Jim Davis's excellent presentation yesterday, did you see how much hope it contained? Some people are as close as needing an invitation. Some people need an invitation and a meal at your house. Some just need to see that your church cares about helping the poor and about making your community a better place. That's all pretty doable for a group like the Evangelical Presbyterian Church. In fact, let me say up front how bullish I am on what God is doing through the EPC. Your church planting rate of 6.7% annually, meaning that if you had 1,000 churches exactly, you'd start 67 new ones in a year, is tremendous. It's frankly well ahead of most denominations. But your goal of increasing that rate to 10% per year, that's 100 new churches for every existing 1,000 churches, is going to position you as the Thomas Edison of denominations and church networks. Edison did not give up until he found a durable light bulb, and that breakthrough inspired many others to follow suit. Just like Tim Keller showed that an urban evangelical church can plant and thrive in urban America, so the EPC is showing what God can do if every church is a parent, a partner, and or a patron for church planting. Church planting goes back to the book of Acts, and while I'm sure there were whiners and pessimists back then saying what couldn't be done, look how God used people of faith back then to demonstrate and verbalize the gospel in a culture that compared to today was much more pluralistic, more secular, and even more hostile. Going beyond the EPC, some of the best missionaries in the United States today are church planters. And in my workshops, I've been unpacking the new faces of church planting. And that's my title for what we learned from North America's largest ever study of its kind, involving 2,700 participants, mostly church planters, a few replanters and the like. And what church planters learn and the breakthroughs they discover in finding open doors and receptive hearts for the gospel are powerful insights that all of us can learn from. At ECFA, we made 5 reports from the data, all available for free download at ecfa.org/surveys. Again, free, you heard that? At ecfa.org/surveys. And the topics include, how do you fund them? What are the trends of ethnicity and race? What did the pandemic do to church planting? What are the best predictors of a church's ability to multiply itself? How does church planting compare to multi-site campuses? And more. So hope that's helpful for you. One more housekeeping item before we talk about your church in the year 2050. ECFA is all about helping your, that's Evangelical Council for Financial Accountability. That makes a really big tattoo when you put it on. We want to help your church do integrity well. We want the only stumbling block to the gospel to be the cross of Christ, not some dumb financial or unethical practice that got you into trouble. And of course, as soon as something goes sideways with whoever you are, the first question everybody asks is, and where was the local board, in your case, the local session? And where was it when it happened? How did that happen? And so to become accredited with the ECFA means a church agrees to 7 Bible-based integrity standards, and we put a lot of energy into developing resources to help you along the way. So the QR code reflects our ideas of how new churches can get started right. Long before a church is ready for ECFA accreditation, could we coach you on how to start legally? That's always a good idea. How to set up a budget that can scale as God blesses you with growth. How much cash reserves do you need? What's the wording that your session can use to authorize housing allowance? Yes, you want it to be legal, and more. So scan the code, take a look, maybe at low minutes in my talk, take a look or look at it later. Okay, now on to our topic for this session. My title is, Why is Next Year 2050? And my subtitle is Generations Collaborating for Multiplication. One of my main goals is to bring home your theme verse, 2 Timothy 2:2, in a fresh way. And as I quote it, would you please count with me the generations that are being referred to? So I'll quote, Paul speaking to Timothy, the things you, Timothy, have heard from me in the presence of many witnesses, commit to reliable people who will be qualified to teach others also. That verse totally changed my own perspective on ministry. We just counted 4 generations. When I was working on the book Hero Maker with Dave Ferguson, I started thinking, can I name someone that I led to Christ, who in turn led one or more people to Christ, who in turn led one or more people to Christ, who in turn led one or more people to Christ? And the answer was no. And I've been at this a lot of years. I got gray hair. And that hurt. So here's how I'm now applying that verse to my life. And if you hear nothing else I say today, please especially tune in here. Could it be that 2 Timothy 2:2 and other teachings and models in Scripture, that I have not made a disciple of Jesus Christ until I have helped that person begin to make a disciple, and in turn, that person needs to hang on to that disciple, helping them disciple him until the next person is being reproduced as a disciple. Likewise, I've not made an apprentice until I've helped that person begin to make an apprentice. I have not developed a leader until I've helped that person begin to develop a leader. I have not planted a church until I have helped that church begin to start another new church. Okay, with these perspectives in mind, let's talk about the unavoidable trends that every church here is going to face en route to 2050, all of which are taken from an upcoming series of ECFA blogs, so you are seeing it first. One scripture that epitomizes where we're going is the heroic thing that Saul did in 1 Samuel 17. Not only was he willing to let the next generation take on the giants, but Saul made an incredible decision about the tools that had worked so well for him. Let me read it. Then Saul clothed David with his armor. He put a helmet of bronze on his head and clothed him with a coat of mail. And David strapped his sword over his armor, and he tried in vain to go, for he had not tested them. Then David said to Saul, "I cannot go with these, for I have not tested them." So David put them off. Then he took his staff in his hand, and he chose 5 smooth stones from the brook and put them in his shepherd's pouch. His sling was in his hand, and he approached the Philistine. And you and I know what happened next. So let's talk about the vestments that the next generation is inheriting from you and from me as we move from 1950 to 2050. And may I remind you that 2024, today, is a lot closer to 2050 than it is to 1950. But let's start with 1950. And the statistics that I'll be showing today are all from national surveys like Gallup and Pew and the government's social service survey and the like. So, have you seen the TV sitcom Leave It to Beaver? If the Cleaver family went to church, mom, who always wore pearls, dad, who always knew the right thing to do, athletic Wally, and lovable Beaver, they would fit right into most churches in the 1950s. They might fit into a lot of churches yet today. But seriously, the 1950s was a tremendous peak of American church attendance and of ministries being started. A lot of good came out of the 1950s, and so we tend to keep tweaking those methods that God seemed to have blessed so richly. If the 1950s return, so just back on the previous slide. So you see, you add up 66 and 26. That's the vast majority of the church identified in some stream of Christianity. And if the 1950s return, some churches are still actually waiting and ready for that day. But even so, interestingly, most church-going Christians today are optimistic about their church's future. This particular survey comes from 2022, when many churches were just beginning the road to rebuilding after the pandemic. So while the 1950s may not be coming back, sorry, and while your people are actually optimistic about the future of your church, here are 8 shifts that your people and you, helped by your young Davids and your young Esthers, will need to address in order to speak the unchanging gospel to an ever-changing culture. Trend number 1, from attendance to attachment, why church membership is losing its appeal and what's replacing it. Church membership is going down. Here's a 100-year run, starting with 1950, when membership was 74%. 3 out of 4 people were members and virtually all of a church. Running to 2020, when membership dipped to 47%, so less than half of Americans were members of a church, synagogue, or mosque. And then I projected the trend line out to 2050. But maybe membership is no longer is the word or concept that meets the need that was originally behind the term when it was popularized. Maybe people don't care as much about having their name on a list as having friends to do their spiritual journey with. Not attend, but attach. Not be a member, but belong and feel that you belong. The shift that's coming is a heightened sense of forming my identity through the body of Christ, that these are the people who care about my spiritual well-being, who want to do life with me, who want to help me shape my values, who make me feel that I belong. Makes you kind of think about the dominant metaphor of the church in the New Testament as the body of Christ. And if that's what you help me understand the concept of membership to be, then keep the word. Or maybe you'll come up with a different word to describe not just my beliefs and a list, but also what it means to be in a community that matters to me. One evidence that this is where the culture is shifting, and this slide comes from the survey in Jim Davis's great dechurching book, is this list of reasons why people have dropped out of church. Look especially at number one and number three. Number one is, I didn't fit in with the congregation. In other words, I might have been a member, but I didn't feel like I belonged and fit in. Number three, I didn't experience much love from the congregation. These are all very solvable, and they're all things that the Bible has a lot to say about. So again, shift number one is from attending to attaching. Shift number two is from nuclear families to forged families. Why churches need to serve a wider range of households. The sobering reality is that the people in your church and mine today, and those that we're trying to reach tomorrow and coming, they're coming from a very different framework than those in the 1950s. The top black line here, those who are married and with children, starting in 1960 and moving up to 2020, is on the decrease. The green line, single adults, are on the increase. And the blue line, single parents with children, are likewise on the increase. If you need a biblical model for how to teach the ideals of Scripture about marriage, about family, but to a wider range of households, it's the term oikos, or household. In Acts 16, for example, Lydia and her household, her oikos, were saved and baptized. That broader term probably ranged from relatives to servants, what we might call today the extended family and adopted close friends. Or in my trend summary, keeping and championing the nuclear family, but also welcoming and accepting the forged family, thereby serving a wider range of households in the name of Jesus. Trend number three is the move from the mind alone, broadening it to include the soul as well. Why the future is birthing a new apologetic. I love the variety in Scripture. How Jesus spoke to Nicodemus in John 3 is very different from how he spoke to the woman at the well in the very next chapter, John 4. How Paul spoke with one group, quoting one of their prophets and introducing them to the unknown God on Mars Hill, was very different from how he gave his testimony to another group. And likewise today, we have to understand how to present the unchanging gospel to an ever-changing audience. Who is that audience? This graphic starts with 1970 at left, and then tracks over time how that's changing. The top black line are Protestants, which are declining primarily by way of the main line. The solid line goes through the early 1920s, and then the dotted line projects us on to 2050. The second line, also black, is the net change in Catholics, blending their serious losses with serious immigration gains. By the way, almost 50% of U.S. Catholicism today is not Italian, is not Irish, but Hispanic. The big rise is in the blue line, those who say they have no religion, commonly referred to as the nuns, or N-O-N-E-S, or no religious preference. This next slide affirms these same ideas in another way. Look at the green on the left. Back in the 1970s, 11% of U.S. households identified themselves as non-religious. By the 2010s, it was 26%. That's well over double, and certainly that's growing more in the 2020s, although interestingly, in the last couple of years, it seems to have leveled off. These changes affirm a problem with using what at least I grew up on, evidence that demands a verdict, which used like logic to rationalize, is Jesus liar, Lord, or lunatic? But that kind of discussion assumes a belief in God, a trust in the Bible. It assumes that truth exists and is knowable, and that truth matters, and many other assumptions, which just doesn't match what people are interested in and the perspectives they bring in coming to a conversation with you. Some have tracked the generations to say that my generation asked before embracing something, well, is it true? And the next generation asked, well, does it work? And the next generation asked, well, is it good? Does it do good for society? The emerging questions that I think are going to shape the next apologetic are, is it beautiful? Is there beauty to it? Does it make the world better? And if there is a God, where is he in my pain? As a result, the emerging best apologetic is a combination of my story, my testimony, if you will, of how God has worked in my life, combined with, and usually starting with, listening to and accepting your story. So when you say, I believe that God, you know, came in an unidentified flying object and looked like a gorilla, and I'm just making this up as I go, our job is to go, well, that's interesting. Tell me more. To listen and hear and validate, and then we've earned our turn to say, well, can I tell you how I've seen God, as I understand him, work in my life? Bottom line, you need your young Davids and young Esthers to coach you, if you're older, in how to connect the unchanging gospel with people's felt needs today. Trend four is from church refugee to church as to church as refuge. It argues that true hospitality is essential for congregations to thrive. Hospitality is epitomized in Scripture by meals. Thou preparest a table for me in the presence of my enemies, or friends, over which people give and receive, treating each other with a level of equality and getting to know each other relationally. The term church refugees, which comes from a book by Josh Packard, refers to Christians who have left their church in pain. Church as refuge refers to church as a safe place for healing of those hurts. I was in one church for a number of years where every few months the pastor would say something like, if you've been hurt by church in the past, I want to apologize on behalf of what you've experienced, and I'd love to help you find healing. And there has always been a response. There is hurt, but the church can be a refuge for that. Two different directions, stemming the people who leave and being a refuge for those who come back. So an essential shift, it's a simple shift, because church homogeneity is on the decline. Conflict and friction are on the rise. This graph depicts the source of congregational ranks, the sources of congregational conflict. And if you had guessed, okay, what are the big sources of congregational conflict, that disagreement over doctrine and theology would have been at the top, no, that's at the bottom of the list. The top of the list is member behavior. It's kind of a Snoopy cartoon. I love humanity. You know, it's people I can't stand. Church members not getting along. As the social glues that bind us are unraveling, churches not only are but will face more conflict, and people are quicker to just slam the door and walk. We got to do a better job of increasing the glue that holds us together and causes us to work things out. And it's a personal connection embodied in the biblical term of hospitality. This next graph affirms that healthy conflict resolution can occur and is occurring if we limit it to congregations that defined by high vitality, marked by vibrant worship, healthy leadership, and growth. And the gist is that these congregations are willing and able to address conflict openly. Okay, if I'm not in enough hot water, I'm going for the diciest term trend of all. At least this one is diciest for me to personally process. The bottom line is that younger generations of believers want to hear what the Bible says and frankly expect to hear how the gospel speaks to today's social issues. The rising generation is nicknamed, among other things, the Justice Generation. Not only do they care deeply and want to be involved in making the world a more just society, but if I'm silent about Scripture on various justice issues, they think something is a matter with me and something is a matter with the Jesus that I preach. Here is a secular national survey of how Gen Z and young millennials rank the issues that concern them today. This is what's on the minds and hearts of people that your church and mine want to reach. Let me just underscore the first one, mental health. This is not going away. The Surgeon General has declared it an epidemic. In fact, it is growing. Anxiety, loneliness, stress. These are all issues that Jesus, the Gospels, all of Scripture have much to say about. So as you read Scripture, as you read leadership books that feature Scripture, ask yourself, as you network with various ministry friends and colleagues, ask yourself what dimensions of the gospel that you haven't brought out adequately, where you might need to move from silence to speaking more on the role of God's justice. Trend number 6, ask the Revelation 7:9 question that the EPC is all about. If heaven will be made up of every tribe on earth, and if the Lord's prayer is that God's will be done in heaven as it is on earth as it is in heaven, then how can your church embody not a tokenism, but a racial healing and reconciliation that leads to community blessing? The top rows of this slide are from the U.S. Census Bureau, both its history and its projections. Let me walk you through the far left columns. Look at white in 1950. You see the 88%? That was America in 1950. Now look ahead to 2050, same column of the projection, 44% in 100 years. That is a sea change. Look at the next column, Hispanic. 1950, 2%. 2050, 27%, a quarter of our nation. Wow. Here, as with each of the trends, I'm not trying to give you prescriptive steps. Instead, for each, I'm trying to nominate a topic for ongoing discussion that church leaders, older and younger together, need to talk through to help their church prepare for the future. As Wayne Gretzky in hockey said, "How are you such a good hockey player? I don't go to where the puck is. I go to where the hockey puck is going to be." I'm proposing to you that these are the rising issues to focus on. Trend 7, 8 total, involves these wonderful electrons that God has created, and during the pandemic, that virtually every church in America used to expand their ministry online. This shift is from physical only to a healthy hybrid approach, both for your outreach and for your discipleship. Let me ask for a show of hands. How many of you regularly read your Bible or use an app, regularly read your Bible online or use an app for Bible reading or prayer? Okay, the jury is in, if you looked around. For how much more, and it's only growing, of church life is going to increasingly happen online. The reality is that for most churches, small and large, the biggest online expression is the streaming of worship. And the biggest online challenge is the same one you have with in-person church. For years, you've looked at your in-person audience and asked, "Hey, we got lots of bodies here. How do I lead them to take the next step of discipleship? To volunteer, to join a group, to serve, to give, to disciple someone else, to come to pizza with the pastor, or whatever." Now, it's the same challenge that churches are facing with online audiences, except I can't see them, and I can't chase you out the door, meaning follow you, not run you off, because I don't know who you are. You have to self-identify first. So how to get online audiences to take the next step of discipleship, and in so doing to reveal their names and a bit about themselves, is the ongoing challenge of this generation, and it's only going to get more by 2050. One of the many implications of the rise of online engagement is these magnificent buildings won't be as packed because so many people are having their meetings or other things online. So here are some of the fresh, creative ways of using existing church facilities. For churches that rent or donate their space to other groups, which is the vast majority, here's some examples of what they do. They let nonprofits use them, support groups, other congregations. Wow, that's just awesome that one out of three churches in America that shares its building in some way has recently or currently is letting another church worship in it. That's awesome. Other groups, daycare or preschool, government, and so forth. The final trend, as you prepare your church for the future, ask, what do you measure? We've learned that attendance doesn't equal discipleship. We've learned that healthy growth is more important than growth for growth's sake. We've learned that people continue to be very spiritual, that the U.S. is stubbornly religious, as that quote that Jim Davis used. They are reachable. And in case you're looking at this and saying, is that really true? The vast majority of people who never reach them better. You can help figure that pathway out. To me, the rise of the nuns is actually a good thing because, by and large, they are not people who have given up on their belief in the supernatural. Instead, they used to have a label. Well, don't talk to me because I'm Presbyterian. I don't know what Presbyterians are. We never go to a Presbyterian church. I don't even know we're a Presbyterian church. But our family is Presbyterian. Don't talk to me. Now that's gone. People are saying, okay, to be honest, I'm nothing. I really don't. I know I had a heritage, but it doesn't mean anything to me. And with today's generation, if I trust you, I am willing to hear your perspective on faith. It's one less barrier to not have that label, and it's one more step toward you in that people are willing to talk faith issues. Figuring out how to do that is increasingly the challenge that churches will face towards 2050. So here's the bottom line to existing churches. You must involve your next generation of leaders in ongoing conversations that will help you prepare for the future. You, senior leaders and younger Davids and Esthers, must work together. Bottom line for church plants, actually, before I read it, I have a humorous 30-second video clip that shows a very lovable church planter. Happens that he's talking to the head of Portable Church Industries, which is one of the many excellent groups that that serves as church planters. But I just want you to enjoy him.
We're going to need a lot of stuff.
That's okay.
I don't think you realize how far ahead of the curve we are.
Right.
You can get everything we need.
Yes.
Digital soundboard.
Yes.
3 video screens.
Yeah.
I mean, 4 video screens.
Yeah.
Tons of lights, multiple wedges, vertical truss. Did I say 4 screens? I meant 6.
If that's what you need.
Obviously, we'll need cases with wheels.
We build those for you.
Probably trailers to haul everything.
We will get you the right ones.
Signage.
Just tell us what you want them to say.
We'll probably have a lot of kids around.
And we will put those toys together for you.
They're from IKEA.
Bring it on.
Impressive.
Do you need any consultation on fundraising?
No. Yes. Please.
Okay, that guy and the women and men like him is the type of person that God is using to change the world. And church planters, as you find the breakthroughs in reaching a new generation for Jesus, you need to show the rest of us how. I've got one more application to my message, and that's to the EPC in general, specifically to the EPC. But somewhere along the line in my message, I wanted to tell you about some resources that I think you'll find helpful, and I didn't want to make that my ending point. So if you'll let me insert right here a 3 or 4 minute commentary to point you to some practical, helpful resources, then I'll come back to my EPC applications, and then we'll take our stretch break, and then we'll have our panel. First, here's some great books that will take my topic deeper. The Nuns by Ryan Burge. You heard from him. The Great De-Churching by Jim Davis. Awesome. Growing Young. This is by the Fuller Institute team. This is on if your congregation's average age is much higher than the average age in your community, how do you young'un your church? And there are other books that you can ask your friends about. So maybe tonight over dinner, ask someone, hey, besides the Bible, what's a really helpful ministry book you're reading? And if someone asks you and you don't have a reply, and Tom Ricks is sitting right there, he's going to like this, here's what you can say. I heard the EPC church planting team has a great book online titled Church Planting 101 with a subtitle, An Introduction to Becoming a Multiplying Church. I'm going to be reading that one soon. That can be your line. Someone else to train is your church finance person, so please encourage them to subscribe to ECFA Pulse. It's free. Our tips are designed not only to save you money, but to keep you legal. So just go to ecfa.org/pulse, select church, and let ECFA serve you in that way. We really want to help you do integrity well. I'm ECFA's research director, so whenever I do new research, it gets featured in the Pulse. And I hope you'll read, for example, our research on how to become a more effective in your session meetings. That's the blue cover document titled Unleashing Your Church Board's Potential. We also have a number of video shorts, again, all free. This one on the 3 best ways to grow your church's level of cash reserves. And we have a backdoor for smaller churches that gets you and or your church finance person or administrator or all of you free relevant resource each month, from a webinar to an ebook. It's good stuff. Just go to churchexcel.org. And there is how to reach me. It's the email that really goes to me, and if I don't reply back to you, then write again, but I do want to serve you. And finally, if you are a larger church, consider becoming an ECFA member. Maybe start by talking to existing ECFA members like Cornerstone in Brighton, Michigan, Forest Hill in Charlotte, North Carolina, Heartland in Olathe, Kansas, First Pres in Orlando, Florida, Hope Church in Richmond, Virginia, Cherry Creek in Englewood, Colorado, or South Fellowship in Littleton, Colorado as well. Okay, so thank you. Now I want to come back and land with a few challenges to the EPC, and then we'll have our stretch break, and then we'll have our panelists. I'll be referencing five different scriptures. First, Matthew 28, 18 to 20 starts with all authority. How could Jesus have better underscored the importance of what's to follow? All authority in heaven and on earth is mine, he said. And yet he continued, but I have something for you to do. I need you to make disciples of me everywhere, with people you know, with people you don't know, with people like you, with people very different from you. And remember, I am with you wherever you go, even to the end of the earth and of the age. I know you know these verses, but I want to give you a challenge. When you go home this week and you talk about this week and what happened here, how will you remember and label this particular General Assembly? Is your strongest take-home issue or topic, is it going to be, oh, that was the year we dealt with thorny issues in Memphis, Tennessee? Or will a stronger memory prevail? Will you say, that was the week when I made a really big step forward with the Great Commission? I made a decision that we're going to play a greater role in church planting. Oh, you say, we're just one church. Our part doesn't matter that much. Wrong. You don't know how God is going to use your faith. You don't know if the next disciple your church makes is going to become a great evangelist, a great inventor, a great business leader who makes the world a better place, a great athlete with a powerful testimony, a great parent who raises children who, and you could continue this sentence on and on. Let me give you one illustration. I'm going to talk about an EPC person that most of you know about. I phoned him last week and I asked, how did you come to Christ? He said that during his teens, his family and him had dropped out of church. His sister's boyfriend came to faith, and then she came to faith, and they invited him to a special youth emphasis at church, and he said no repeatedly. He said it was about the 100th invitation, and he finally agreed to go. He sat in the balcony, and at the pastor's invitation, he yielded everything he knew of himself to everything he understood of God so far. He started going to Young Life. He eventually became a volunteer in Young Life. He got married and went to seminary. He accepted a role as a youth pastor at Second Presbyterian here in Memphis. Got any ideas yet? He got involved with the efforts of Second Pres to start another church. And the first meeting of the potential core group was with two other couples. So I could do this, four people and him. With help from Second Pres, 17 total couples expressed interest, plus Second Pres helped financially. They rented the back of a restaurant that was at the time named Shelby Place. Today it's called the Butcher Block. And they put the nursery in the bar, with the first two nursery workers being his wife and sister-in-law. Would somebody guess his name? Craig Strickland. That's the founding pastor of this church. And while most new churches don't turn out this way, Almost every new church does start with a lot of challenges, such as a nursery in the bar. Are we really going to do this? Are we really going to be able to reach people for Christ like this? And how to bridge from my core group of the converted to reaching the unconverted? Back to Matthew 28. What if each person here decided, my biggest decision this week is the heightened role I'm going to play either as a parent, a partner, or a patron for church planting. And in the meantime, until I know with clarity, I'm going to regularly lead the church that I lead in the fourth P, and that is prayer. I'm going to make this a matter of congregational prayer. In light of eternity, that is your most important decision this week, I believe. Second, and more briefly, will you review your commitment to being a Revelation 7-9 church? For some of you, that means a walk across the room, forming intentional friendships with more people of different races or ethnicity. For some of you, it means intentionally listening to a person of a different race, learning from them, and even submitting to them in some way. For some, it means a heightened focus on racial reconciliation, maybe preaching on it, maybe doing something else. How is God speaking to you from the Revelation 7-9 picture of heaven? Third, John 14:12-14. I'm going to read it. Very truly, whoever believes in me will do the works I have been doing, and they will do even greater things than these, because I am going to my Father. And I will do whatever you ask in my name so that the Father may be glorified in the Son. You may ask for anything in my name, and I will do it. Jesus' promise about doing even greater things than these greatly confuses me to this day. But whatever that means, I believe it depends on what Jesus voiced next. And that's where the next verses introduce us to the role of the Holy Spirit. I'd like to play a short clip. This is my last clip. From a recent exponential conference where a woman named Sarah Jackson tells what can happen when the Spirit works through ordinary human circumstances like accidentally leaving her daytimer at someone's house.
I just want to close on this story. I was at a party on the other side of the city, and I got home, and as I took my coat off, I suddenly remembered I left my diary in the kitchen of the party, and I was so fed up. But I'm one of those really sad people. I can't function without my diary. It's got everything in it. I look at it the night before. What am I doing the next day? So I was like, I'm just going to have to drive back over there, and maybe they'll all be awake still. So I'm halfway across the city, and if I'm honest, I'm having one of those conversations. Sarah, you're so stupid. Are you going to be so tired? And what if they're not awake? What if you drive all the way across the city and they've all gone to bed? And so I was like, okay, well, this is what I'll do. I'll drive, I'll park the car. If the light's still on, I'll then just knock at the door, and then I'll get my diary. Anyway, I parked the car, saw the light was on. Good. Knocked on the door, and brilliantly, my friend answered the door. And I was like, oh, I'm so pleased you're awake. He looked at me, and he looked like he'd seen a ghost. It's like his jaw dropped. He said, Sarah, you're here. I was like, yeah, I'm so sorry. I've just left my diary in the kitchen. If I can just grab it, I'll be out of your hair. And great party, by the way. And he was like, but Sarah, you're here. I was like, yeah, because I just left my diary in the kitchen. And he said, come in. And we went to the kitchen, and being good Brits, made a cup of tea. And we talked. We had a post-mortem about the party and who got on with who. And then he went really quiet, and he said this to me. He said, Sarah, it was a great party. He said, but I was surrounded by all our friends, but I've never felt so lonely. And as everyone left, I sunk deeper and deeper. And by myself, I feel suicidal. I want to end it. And as I was thinking those thoughts, you came into my mind. And I thought, you're always so smiley, and you're always talking about Jesus and your God. And so I said, Sarah's God, if you exist, you prove it to me. He said, I want her to knock on my door. The reason I tell you that story is we wept together. He gave his life to Christ. But I was feeling so unholy on that journey. I didn't see that the sovereign God was using grumbling, angry me in his plan to come and say to my dear friend, I hear you. I see you. The Holy Spirit moves invisibly sometimes. We don't see him. It doesn't mean he's not working. He wants to fill you. He is your gift. He is your secret source. He is the power that's going to transform our ministries.
Wow. So the next time you forget your cell phone somewhere, maybe somebody's going to come to Christ through it. Whenever God is at work, that's when greater things happen. Fourth, Luke 10:2. The harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. Ask the Lord of the harvest, therefore, to send out workers into his harvest field. I predict that the biggest obstacle in hitting and sustaining your goal of 10% church planting will be the lack of workers, that is, of potential church planters. Jesus gives you a powerful resource, praying to the Lord of the harvest that he will send out those workers. God's job is to call and to send, and your job is to identify those that God is calling and help them process that call. And if you get your part right, there will be enough workers. And what is your part? Final slide. It includes the building a culture that embodies 2 Timothy 2:2. I quoted it earlier with one emphasis, but this time I want to quote it to affirm that it's not just about you and one person. Listen, the things you, Timothy, have heard from me in the presence of many witnesses, commit to reliable people who will also be qualified to teach others also. This is a multiplication. Your part is to build a leadership development perspective of multiplication into everything that happens in your ministry and in the life of the church. And if you do, I believe you will experience the titles of this message. You'll be prepared for 2050, and you'll involve generations collaborating for multiplication. With God, all things are possible. Amen. Let's take a 5-minute stretch, and we'll be back with better speakers than me.